Hello, good evening. You're welcome to Truthful Irish Alt Island Radio. How are you? Before I get into trouble, hello to Anne-Marie Devereaux in Galway, Anna D'Alessandro in Dublin, June in Dublin, Michelle, I'm going to call you Cat Lady, Cat Woman. You're doing remarkable work for them poor little kittens and cats down there. Fair play to you. Good on you. As I said before, can't wait to hear you singing again. Bobby Toll, how are you? Passed through your neck of the woods earlier on, stuck in traffic, so I was. So that's why I'm a little bit late this evening. Rob Harford, you're the man over there in Australia. Keep up your brilliant post. Love you to bits. Jerry Brown and Co., it's getting nearer the time I'll actually see you in person. Well, I don't know where you are in the world, let me know. But I just want to say this before I go too far. If you want to get in touch with me, O'BrienLarry5@gmail.com is how you can reach me. For right now, until we improve this system that we're working on. Chris had everything coded and I'm baffled by science trying to work out how we went live and how we did everything. So I'm just doing podcasts. Wherever you are in the world, you're very welcome. It's lovely to talk to you. Please get in touch, leave a comment and share. Truthful Irish on YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, all over the world. Thank you. Alrighty. Here's a subject that's going on all over the world and it's absolutely shocking. It's gone on for too long, no matter where you live. It's the subject of couples who are expecting a child being expected to go through draconian laws where the lady's partner is not allowed in to the hospital for appointments and labour. Now I know it's changing a little bit, but it's still being restricted and I don't for one minute understand why or how it makes any sense that it can restrict a couple at the most critical time in their relationship or in their lives, and certainly in the life of their beautiful little angel coming into the world, where you would put them under pressure. A doctor would tell a pregnant lady, stress is bad for your pregnancy and for your health. And yet, the health board are forcing stress onto ladies in particular and couples in general. Here's the latest news in Ireland. See what you think and leave a comment on this.
In terms of scans and labour and everything else, these situations whereby, you know, most hospitals signed up, others hadn't, you say by the end of this week there would be uniformity?
I'm saying by today, right?
Today.
So the HSE and I were looking at this very closely last week. There was another review done. The last time actually we were here, I was giving you the latest audit.
Why did it take so long? Because I know it's 2 months since this was meant to all end. It's a month ago since you expressed your absolute frustration, I think, was to quote you, that this was still happening. I mean, that this kind of feudal lords and their fiefdoms not implementing policy.
Most of it was dealt with, right? And by the end of last week, there are 19 maternity units around the country. 16 of them were reporting as fully compliant. 3 of them said they weren't. And they gave an undertaking that by today, now the HSE will be checking, but that by today, the 4 criteria we discussed before would be in place. And just for your listeners, that's a minimum 30-minute visit a day during full labour. That includes from being induced right the way through, if being induced is part of it.
No waiting to the last minute.
None of that. The anomaly scan and then NICU, where that is required,
yeah.
the neonatal intensive care, right? Now, on top of that, this week we're looking at emergency, and I want to go further, and indeed the HSE wants to go further. So the next level is the antenatal appointments as well.
How long, though, are we going to keep hearing these stories? Because, like I said, it's 2 months since we were told that restrictions should be lifted, and it's only today that you say there's going to be uniformity across the board. I mean, will I be speaking to you, it's now June, at some point in August, and you say, yeah, finally now, you know, in emergency situations, people are allowed in. As you said, an awful lot of women miscarry every day in this country. How many more Jims and Johns and everybody else are we going to have contacting the show for the next 8 weeks?
When we talked, I think there were, 14 of the 19 were reporting as fully compliant. There were 5 that we mentioned. That came down to 3. And as of today, it should be none. And then the emergency.
It took 8 weeks to get there. And I mean, if you're only looking at an emergency from today, is it going to be another 8 weeks? Are we going to have all of this again in a month's time? You expressing your frustration. I wish the hospitals would do what we're telling them. But again, Jim is left out in the car park. Is this?
Oh, Jim is every man in Ireland and in the world. When the health minister tells a hospital to follow his instructions, shouldn't it just be done? There shouldn't be weeks of waiting.
It's going to go on for another 8 weeks. The plan is that in the coming weeks, so we're only talking 3 or 4 weeks, the plan is in the coming weeks, the emergency visits, just like that heartbreaking situation, would be facilitated.
Yeah. Yeah. I think it's the lowest of the low to put a pregnant lady through stress. Now, that's my opinion, and I am not a doctor, but you don't need to be to use common sense. For first-time moms, it must be the most frightening experience of their life in some cases, and in others, thank God, they sail through and everything is great, and that's brilliant. But for God's sake, the government here in Ireland and around the world, they need to stop this evil control of the most wonderful thing in a couple's life, bringing a child into the world. We're going across to News Talk, where Kira and Mark, as always, are discussing our outdoor summer. Our outdoor summer is basically that you can go out to a pub, bar, hotel, restaurant and dine outside. And in Ireland, that means you're sitting in the rain. Do you want flies with that?
Mark, just before the news, you were discussing with Adrian Cummins the legalities around outdoor dining. This is, of course, due to the Gardaí, particularly in Galway, saying that pubs and restaurants are not allowed to serve alcohol, but not just in general out to people on the streets, but in recently set up seating areas outside premises that were actually authorised by local authorities. What do you make of it, Mark?
Well, I thought it was bonkers that it hadn't been sorted out in the first place. Who had the authority? Who had the right to say, yes, you could, and no, you couldn't? But now that it's there, I was just thinking, obviously, all of these have to have pretty stiff public liability insurance. If something happens, drink-related, brawl, fight, an accident, whatever the hell, and it is as a result of alcohol sold in that part on the pavement, outside your premises, and there's a claim, who's liable?
Who's liable? But remember, if you go into a bar and you have a few drinks and you come outside, fall over, God forbid, and have an accident, who was ever liable? Has it changed?
Will your insurance cover you?
God knows. And we are quite the litigious. We often used to look over at America and go, oh God, they're very litigious over there. We are highly litigious. Our, you know, all kinds of shops and restaurants and all say that their public liability insurance is hammered quite regularly with people making claims.
Listen, people take a case for falling off a swing.
Some people may take a case for some nameless people.
Oh, there's a great broadcaster. People make a claim for falling off a swing. Irrelevant.
May take a case for such things. But look, the reality of it is that we were told to have an outdoor summer. Like, I know in my own main street around the corner from my house, they have extended the eating areas for cafes and restaurants out beyond where they used to be. And proper order, because we want people to be outside. We're in a pandemic. But now it turns out that the legal underpinning of this is wrong. I mean, can we get anything right by way of planning?
Well, it appears not. But I'm just interested. As this is unfolding, businesses are waking up going, hang on a second here. Whoa. And God, look, after everything they've gone through, after the financial hit they've taken, and the uncertainty about whether they're actually going to survive and get through to the other side of this,
that now the prospect that if something happened outdoors, and, you know, accidents do happen.
Of course they do.
And the fact that, well, God forbid the accident happens, but if it does happen and you are not covered, not alone could you be put out of business, you could be in debt for a very long time.
Yeah, so now I suppose businesses are looking kind of going, I want to serve people sitting in those seats over there because I'm desperate to have enough capacity outdoors.
Stop. Did I hear right? If a publican sells you alcohol in an outdoor setting, which the government said is okay, and you have an accident, are they liable? All right. If that same publican who owns an off-license sells you alcohol, and you go out into the street and drink it, fall over and have an accident, God forbid, I hope you don't, who's liable? I'll say it again. What has changed? It's always been like that.
Would it be viable? But on the other hand, am I covered? Am I breaking a law? Am I insured? Is it worth the risk? Let us know, what do you make of this issue? Have the government dropped the ball on the outdoor summer?
Yeah, maybe. I probably think that they have dropped the ball, and because I don't know, because everything changes, and as Truthful Irish would say, I don't know, it's yes or no. Anyway, Paul Reid is one of our brilliant experts here in Ireland. I don't know how he sleeps at night, but listen to this and please get in touch.
Well, I know it's like Groundhog Day to some extent, you and I discussing vaccinations, and I understand entirely that the HSE has been at the mercy of supply chains and I suppose deficits in those supply chains. But can you give us some kind of clarity around what we might expect from the rollout of vaccine over the next month or two?
It's amazing how the mainstream media can talk about that subject without being blocked, banned, or anything else, and we can't, and we're the people who pay for them.
Yeah, good morning, Ciara, and it is only a few weeks, but it seems like a long time ago since we were talking about supply lines of about 40,000 a week, and now when we look, we just look even into last week for a look ahead. Last week just finished yesterday. We had most likely over 340,000 vaccines administered in a week, 4 of the 7 days at over 52,000 vaccines administered. So really strong week as we look through. And even yesterday with the good announcement of opening the vaccine to those over the age of 39, those at the age 39, 47,000 vaccines are registrations already up to this morning on that. So really strong momentum throughout. As we look forward, both last week, this week and the following week are quite strong in terms of supply lines. So we will be staying above the 300,000 per week vaccines administered and rolling out down through the ages as we are at the moment. So it's not that strong for the next 3 weeks. What then happens in July is we go back to forecasted levels, because these 3 weeks are a function of Pfizer in particular bringing forward deliveries from quarter three into June and into quarter two. But then we go back to forecasted supply line, so it does drop back.
I'm sorry. In the modern world of communication, on a radio station that is worth millions, they can't even clear up a phone line for very important information. So I just paused it there to retweet it here myself, retweak the system, and hopefully you'll hear them better right now. I'm doing this live, by the way, even though it's going out as a podcast.
Those levels of probably just around 200,000 in July, but still strong momentum as we head into it.
Okay. And I know that the previously sort of touted target of 80% of adults by the end of June is gone, but what kind of percentage by the end of June will we see? And I'm not saying asking this in a critical way, I'm just kind of trying to get a sense of where we're at. So by the end of June, it won't be 80%. What will it be?
Yeah, well, if you look at where we are today, I mean, there's just over 3.6 million administered in total, and that's dose ones, that's about 2.3 million, which is about two-thirds of the adult population, 66% today, if you take that. And then on the fully vaccinated, about 35% of the population are fully vaccinated. So that's kind of where we are today. If you look forward to the next couple of weeks, a lot of dose twos will continue and dose ones. So, you know, we'll be in the region of 70 or over 70%, I expect, but it's you know, we have a key focus obviously on those tools and also particularly on the AstraZeneca dose tools okay. in the next 3 weeks. So.
Now, we're about to see, I suppose, people in their 30s be allowed to register on the portal, and you've been going on that stepwise way down through the age group. So we're coming into the younger cohorts now. Vaccine hesitancy is different among the younger cohorts. They know that they're not at as much risk from COVID as the older population were, and it seems that many of them are more reluctant to take the vaccine. Are you concerned about this?
Well, we would obviously monitor this as well ourselves and do regular surveys. And survey indications are still quite strong about take-up as we move through the ages. Now, obviously, we've had very strong take-up, particularly, you know, even from the 50s up, it's been really strong. Ireland is ranked as one of the best in the world on take-up. So, obviously, yeah, we want to continue that process. I mean, the indications from yesterday are very strong, the registrations on the portal. And interestingly, over 99% of them have registered directly on the portal, so they didn't go through our kind of support line, which is kind of indicative as we're heading at the younger population. So now we would be remaining confident because I think there's been good take-up in Ireland. I think people want to see that continue. I think families have sacrificed so much. We do expect to see good take-up again.
Okay. Moving on to something else. We were talking earlier on the programme here, myself and Mark, about, I suppose, travel advice. We were told by the government, the Taoiseach and the Taoiseach told us about 4 weeks ago, 4 to 6 weeks ago, that we were signing up to the EU digital cert for travel, that meant we were going to be allowed to travel if we had a vaccine, if we had a negative PCR, or if we had a previous confirmed history of COVID. Last week, the head of NPHET, Dr. Tony Holohan, came out and said, you should only travel if you're vaccinated. So there is a variance in the advice that people are being given, I suppose, between government and NPHET, and that's unhelpful. I would.
Yeah, I said it before, folks. You know, I did. We paid for our passports as European and Irish citizens to give you freedom of travel. You're not allowed to do it now because of this. digital passport, and you will not be refunded or given an extension to your ordinary passport if you ask. So they put your money in their pocket and tough luck to you.
Suggest to you before we even ask you a question, but that's unhelpful, you know, mixed messages. What's the HSE's view on this?
Yeah, I think this is a really interesting one because, like, with anything else with COVID, like everything else with COVID throughout, certainly NPHET and CMO give advice, and ultimately government have to evaluate that advice and make policy decisions. But there's also the individual personal risk assessment that people have always done and will always need to do, particularly in relation to travel. So from an HSE perspective, government will make the policy and that will determine policy direction. But what we would say, and I would say, is we're still dealing with a very live threat of the variant. You know, this is not a normal summer, per se. Appreciate people, particularly young people, want to travel. But if you do look what's happening around the world, the UK have just recently announced they're going to keep the restrictions on overseas travel for now to protect against new variants. Belgium have banned travel in the UK. So fully appreciate people need a break, particularly young people need a break. But there is a personal risk assessment, you know, that we all have to make. And the only last thing I'd say is, personally, from a HSE perspective, I remember giving advice to government back in the early stages, you know, on this year. And one of the strongest advice was we just can't let our health system go back to where we were in January, for the public's perspective.
We can't let our health service go back to where we were in January. Yeah. Except in January, we have heard reports from qualified doctors, professors, people who work in hospitals saying, there was no major change in the situation in our hospitals. And that is not only here in Ireland, it's around the world. I'm not going to interrupt the next podcast, and you'll know why when you hear it. And this applies to Ireland and more than likely where you live.
How big a problem is the Delta variant, do you think?
It's a very significant problem. So we've seen that it's more than 90% of cases in Britain. We're seeing it's growing in prevalence very quickly in Northern Ireland and in countries around Europe. The the information is still coming in. We're watching the UK very closely, and the exact numbers are moving around. But what we know about the Delta variant is it seems to be a lot more contagious. It seems to be significantly more severe in terms of the risk of being hospitalized, and it appears to be less susceptible to vaccines, certainly in terms of just having one vaccine dose. So it's a very, very serious
variant. Is it going to be the dominant variant pretty quickly? Is that what your understanding?
What the experts tell me is that variants like this, which are so much more contagious, inevitably become the dominant variant, as it has in Britain and is rapidly becoming in several EU countries. So really the question for us is what needs to be done to make sure as many people as possible are fully vaccinated, because certainly the science would suggest that it is inevitable that these more contagious variants become dominant.
I see, for example, in my own hometown of Dundalk, there's a new walk-in centre established. There's lots of places we're hearing stories at Lone as well of the Delta variant taking hold. Is that your understanding from around the country?
Yeah, there are. Can I just say on Athlone, that now that you've mentioned it, so the public health message is that for people who were in Athlone socialising by the river, on the west side of the river on Friday, the 11th of June, if they were there and they think they might have been exposed, please just go to one of our HSE walk-in testing centres. And if they're symptomatic, to isolate and contact their GP, and their GP can organise a test. Organise a test for them. The public health response has been quick and localised, but okay. I think, as always, Shane, the public health message is the same, which is this disease is rapidly evolving, and the vaccine program is being hugely successful, but we need to keep looking out for each other, minding each other, and following the good public health guidelines.
I know what you're going to say. I said I wouldn't interrupt, but I am. Basically, what they're talking about there is Athlone, which is in Ireland. There was people out celebrating on different sides of the river, apparently. And it seems to be causing a problem that may bring in local lockdowns. But this was all outdoors, and we were told outdoors was safe. Sorry for interrupting.
Now at a stage where it's 50-50, whether we will fully reopen the economy, indoor hospitality, for example, on July the 5th, is that 50-50 at this stage?
What we need to do is we need to hear from NPHET, and we need to hear the public health advice next week. So we have an approach in place. It's the same approach we've used each time we've done an opening up. Last month, the public health advice was that actually Ireland was doing better than expected, and so we were able to open up quicker. The public health team are watching the Delta variant very, very closely, and we'll see what the data says next week. To give you a sense for how quickly this can move, Shane, just last Thursday, I was talking to the team after NPHET, and it was believed that the Delta variant was about 5% of new cases. And in fact, the data we saw from whole genome sequencing was that the number of new cases of the Delta variant was actually falling week on week, it had peaked about 4 or 5 weeks ago. But then new information that's come in just in the last few days shows that it could be up to 20% of more of cases. So it's a rapidly evolving situation. So what we need to do is what we always do, which is let the scientists, let the public health doctors do their thing. Let's let them pore over the analysis.
When will you make the decision?
And then come to cabinet.
On the reopening?
Cabinet and the COVID committee in NPHET will be meeting through next week on exactly those issues.
Yep. You must have heard by now, lockstep. And lockstep is basically every country following the same script. Basically, Ireland was supposed to open up. The UK was supposed to open up. The UK, as you know, especially if you live there, have pushed it from June to July, maybe August, September, November, I don't know, on the same theme. We'll carry on listening to the experts.
Can the July reopening go ahead, given the concerns about it?
Well, first of all, I think the situation has been positive, certainly up to now, in terms of the incidence level, and the disease has been declining over the last number of weeks, and the most recent letter from NPHET confirms that. But of course, the share of the incidence is changing, and there is a significant increase in the incidence of the Delta variant as a share of the overall incidence of the virus. So we will obviously keep this under very close monitoring. I think we all have to be vigilant, and I think the vaccination program is rolling out very well. I mean, 340,000 last week. Next week will be a very big week for vaccination. So I'd appeal to people, particularly in terms of the second dose, to go and make sure you take your second dose when offered, because that is important.
Okay. We are being told that this medical intervention into your life is safe. So why is it necessary to have 2, 3, 4, 5 multiplied by a billion instead of just 1? Or instead of having 1 and then 2, why not put them together and give you 1? If it's so safe, what's the problem?
And I think we will take further advice then next week from NPHET in relation to the prevalence of the Delta variant and in terms of the broader picture in terms of the reopening. But so far, we had a very positive story over the last number of weeks in terms of the overall incidence of the virus itself. But certainly in the last number of days, the share of the Delta variant.
The Delta variant. Right. This is Truthful Irish just talking off the top of his head. When election time comes around again, and it will, won't it be a great idea if the Irish people and the people of the world in general say, oh, I was going to vote for you, but then I had a variant thought that maybe I shouldn't based on your history, because the percentage of your TDs and politicians made me worry and made me stress, so I'd probably vary who I vote for.
Has certainly gone up and it has increased, and that is a concern. And that has to be a concern, but it's similar to what's happening across Europe in terms of the Delta variant becoming a stronger variant.
Are you sounding a note of warning then that July mightn't be able to happen?
I'm simply saying that obviously with what's happening across Europe and in the United Kingdom, we'll be keeping a very close eye on the Delta variant. So far so good in terms of the reopening, and so far so good in terms of our the fact that the virus and the incidence has decreased in the last number of weeks. But we have to take note of the increase in the prevalence of the Delta variant.
I'm once again confused. The cases have gone down, but they're not, because they've gone up because of a variant. In other words, the government are telling you they've gone up so they can do what they want to take your rights away again for your own good.
And be very vigilant, and therefore people have to be vigilant in their personal behaviour. And I think the vaccination programme is key, because over the last number of weeks, for example, the incidence of the virus now in the over 65 is very, very low. And then in that into the 50 to 65 group, it's declining. So the vaccination programme has really been impactful in reducing the incidence of the disease. So there is this parallel race going on, essentially, to get as many people vaccinated as we possibly can, which is reducing the impact of the virus, and at the same time being very vigilant in keeping the pressure on the virus itself.
I don't know what to say. So I'll just put this on instead of listening to me.
Earlier on in the year you were saying, I'm opening on the 1st of July, I don't care who says what. How are you feeling now?
Well, I think the biggest question that we must ask ourselves is what's happened in the last 12 hours for Micheál Martin to have come out and said the Delta variant isn't a concern, and literally overnight he's saying, actually, well, it appears that it's a huge concern now. That's the biggest question we have to ask ourselves, because I don't know what's changed in literally 12 hours. And now the entire restaurant industry, the bar industry, so many other industries are sitting going, what are we doing? We're supposed to be open in 10, 12 days' time. And now we have to wait till next Thursday or Friday, because the government apparently think it's just that easy to open a bar or restaurant. Oh, just open the door, lads, and off you go. And they are literally so far removed from what's going on, it's actually beggar's belief.
One of your tweets today said, another morning of let's blame the restaurants, bars and foreign travel, none of which are open, instead of asking how the hell did the Delta variant get here. No, you didn't use the word hell, but I've just superimposed that. You feel that you're being unfairly blamed in all this and suffering as a result.
I think, Adrian, to be perfectly honest with you, it's actually gone beyond feeling, you know, upset or unfair or whatever. It's actually a joke. It's an absolute joke. I mean, how does the Taoiseach come out 2 or 3 days ago and tell us that the pandemic is over? How and why is there no journalists out there asking these politicians these serious questions? Why are we have 40 in hospital with COVID, not because of COVID, with 13 in ICU with COVID, not because of COVID, that our numbers are way down on last year. We have almost 4 million vaccines given, and we are now in a worse situation than where we were last year. Somebody has to turn around and make these guys accountable, because what they're doing is they come out with the shadowing of great news. Our national debt is in great position, guys, because guess what? Even though we've borrowed more, our interest is lower. But what they won't tell you is that the interest is lower for one reason and one reason only. We've borrowed more money on a much lower rate for now, but we're going to have to borrow even more money on a higher rate to pay back that off, which means our interest is going to go through the roof again. So at some stage, somebody needs to call out this government for the worst useless shower of inept politicians that I have ever encountered in my life.
Okay, Mike.
Ooh, I love you. Go on.
I'm not going to regret saying that. In their defense, you can argue that, you know, they don't want this Delta variant of the virus no more than any of the rest of us do. But we've seen, for example, on this island in the north yesterday, they had 187 new cases. That's their highest level in 100 days. So this is a problem. The virus is increasing. We've seen in Dundalk, they've opened a walk-in test center. In Waterford, they're doing the same, because this virus is starting to spread again.
Adrian, the real simple reality is here is that what we've shown in the last 12 to 16 months is that initially perhaps it worked, but now lockdowns are not the answer. It's as simple as that, because what happens in 3 weeks' time, we're already hearing that the Indian variant plus, we can't call it that, the Delta variant plus is now a major concern in India. But the Indian variant that came out a couple of months back is no longer mentioned in India. Boris is so worried about the Delta variant over in the UK, they're about to put 60,000 fans into Wembley to watch a match in the coming week. So at what stage do we turn around and say, look lads, do you know that living with COVID thing that we mentioned? Well, we actually are going to have to live with COVID, because what is the alternative? Continuous lockdown? I mean, if we were to listen to public health advice forever, we would have been wiped out decades ago because of AIDS, because they told us none of us should be riding each other anymore. So at what point do we turn around and call a halt to this nonsense and discover that the fine line of balance of keeping the economy going and worrying about COVID, we've far reached that. We're in serious trouble now with our economy. I said we have to open up July the 1st in rural Ireland, because otherwise rural Ireland is destroyed.
Okay, let me read out a text that's just come in to me, Paul, and it says, ridiculous, selfish nonsense from Paul Trevoux again. I, of course, feel sorry for publicans and restaurants, but people like him make me question it. He's only concerned about his own pocket.